So it's my privilege at this time to welcome our guest here with us, who's really not a guest. He's part of our River Center. He and Shar have been around here for quite a while. Ed spoke a bunch of times here, but I just wanted to make sure you understand that Ed does a lot for this community. Really huge blessing. Overseeing Transform Lebanon, which are churches in this community that gather together, pray together, encourage one another. He's really instrumental in facilitating that and to walking with many of the pastors, spends time with the pastors, prays with the pastors, just really an encouragement to the pastors in this community, as well as connecting with churches in Corvallis and Albany, his sweet home, and other places around this region. And also one thing I just encourage you, if you've never been part of his ministry, I know the Heart of Revival is a great tool that Ed uses and is part of what he does throughout the week, and is that he ministers to people, not just pastors, but also just individuals like all of us in this room. And if you ever had an opportunity, he puts out this broadcast, Truth Talk, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. And it's excellent. And you can log on there. You can listen to a little short video as he encourages you, as you spend time in your devotions. A great way to do that, just by spending time with what Ed has to say and to encourage you. So it's just a blessing that he's here with us this morning, and we're just really thankful for that. So why don't we give Ed a big River Center welcome? Amen. God bless.
My gear, and there's extra gear here because of the COVID situation, so props. Am I on? I'm showing green. Can you hear me? Testing. We're trying again. Hello? There we are. All right, what if I came up here a little bit differently than what I did? What would you think?
Matthew chapter 7.
Are we on? Well, that's kind of what happened to a man named Nick from Columbus. He's 39 years old. He was acting drunk again and again. His wife, of course, suspected he must be drinking. He denied it. And so she decided to secretly record him. All she saw was him sitting on the couch playing video games all day and getting progressively more drunk through the day. What's happening is that this man has something in his gut that turns carbs into alcohol and causes him to get drunk, even though he's not drinking. It's called auto-brewery syndrome. So he had to drop out of college, and he's appealing a drunk driving conviction now. And the point is that you, like his wife, would have been wrong if you would have come to a judgment. You would have been wrong if you came to a judgment about him because you didn't have all the facts. Now, that's an extreme case, right? And one of the dangers of making judgments, which we're supposed to do, is that we make judgments without all the facts. Maybe a more typical one would be what happened to me. I had a neighbor whose dog came across the field near our house, about 30 feet from our house, the edge of our backyard, and barked incessantly every morning from about 4 a.m., 5 a.m. So I don't love confrontation. I don't know about you, but I just said, we've got to talk to this person. We didn't even know who it was because they're clear across the way. And so I found out who it was, went to this woman's door, and she was very friendly, fortunately. It was a good talk, and things got better. So then maybe a year later, I'm hearing this barking sound again. I go, oh no. I go out the back door. I don't hear anything out there. Maybe it's not the same dog. Go out the front door. I don't hear anything out the front. I conclude it must be our neighbor to the south. Told my wife about it. Here we are again having barking dogs. Turns out it was my refrigerator making a barking dog-like sound. There was no neighbor. So again, I say that just to caution us that we'll make judgments. We often do it without all the facts, so we need to be careful about that. We want to talk about continuing in this series, Jesus' words. And we're going to talk maybe about the most famous words he ever spoken and maybe about the most misused words he ever spoke. Do not judge. You find it in Matthew chapter 7 in Sermon on the Mount. Jesus addressing a Jewish audience. Verse 1 of chapter 7, Gospel of Matthew. Do not judge, or you too will be judged. Did you hear the command? Do not judge. Did you hear the reason for the command? Or you too will be judged. The Amplified puts it beautifully. Do not judge and criticize and condemn others unfairly with an attitude of self-righteous superiority, as though assuming the office of a judge, so that you will not be judged unfairly. So it's a warning against being a sharp, unjust critic. It's a warning against having a critical spirit towards people. It's taking the place of God in our hearts in how we judge people. My wife and I, Shar, she's working today, she's a nurse, have about as different of personalities as two people can possibly have. So I am a structured person, disciplined person, routine person. The challenge for me is to be flexible and to go with the flow. That doesn't come easy to me, right? So when I plan a vacation, I plan everything out, right? Some of you go, oh, please, it's vacation. My wife is on the other end. She's fun-loving, spontaneous, and struggles with routines and disciplines. She's trying to walk on a regular basis, and sometimes she doesn't get to it. And so one morning, she was going to walk before work, and I was hoping she would, because I'm big on fitness and everything. And she didn't. She got late. No time for walking, and I said something about it, and there was a little edge to my comment. And she said, are you judging me? And I had to say, yes, I am. I'm sorry. So what causes this kind of critical spirit, this playing God towards people? What's the cause of that? This arrogant attitude that says, I'm a self-made man. I'm working hard at who I've become. What's wrong with you? I made myself a good person. Why haven't you? What's missing from that kind of attitude is the gospel of grace. That we are recipients of something tremendous that we don't deserve. We deserve the opposite. So I made up this little allegory. Suppose that a person is wanting eternal life. And so they go to the building that says eternal life. And they go in and they find the office that says Jesus. And they speak with Jesus and say, I want eternal life. How do I find it? And surprisingly, Jesus says, oh, you've come to the wrong office. Go down the hall to the law office and speak to a man named Moses. And so a person goes down to the law office, finds Moses, and says, I'm looking for eternal life. What do I need to do? And Moses begins to ask some of the Ten Commandments, how he's keeping them. Like, have you honored your father and mother? Have you stolen? Have you lied? Have you coveted? And this man just breaks down. And he realizes, I am guilty. I've done those things. What do I do, Moses? Can you help me? And Moses surprisingly says, I can't help you. I'm just here to point out your sin. Go back to the Jesus office. So he heads back to the Jesus office, broken over his sin, and Jesus says, you've come to the right place. My Father sent me to die for your sins and to rise from the dead so that your sin record would be wiped out and that you would have a new heart that loves the things that God loves. That's the gospel, and that's what's missing from our lives when we have this critical, judgmental spirit towards people. So when I have that, one of two things, it's indicating one of two things. Number one, I've never experienced the saving grace of God, so I'm not passing it on. Or number two, I've forgotten who I am and what Christ has done for me. I hope that's the case in my case. I trust it is. Let me ask you this question. Since only God is qualified to judge people in a condemning way, and we are not, who do you have a critical spirit towards? Is there someone that you are playing God with in your heart by judging and condemning them? Verse 2. For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Another translation puts it really simply. God will be as hard on you as you are on others. He will treat you exactly as you treat them. Now listen to the ridiculous picture that Jesus gives in verse 3. He says, why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when all the time there is a plank in your own eye? It's like this. Oh, brother, you've got a speck in your eye. Let me take that out for you. It is a ridiculous picture, isn't it? What he's saying here is that the sin of the critic is worse than the one that's being corrected. It's the sin of hypocrisy. The log in your eye, or the plank, or the board, is bigger than the speck or piece of sawdust in the other person's eye. I used to teach elementary school back in the 80s, and sometimes that involved being on playground duty. And that meant kids coming and telling on other kids. So-and-so is being mean to me. They won't share the swing. Or maybe there's a fight. He started it. Do you know what I never heard? I'm being mean to kids. I started a fight. It was all my fault. I'm being a bully. I won't share the swings. Nobody ever came and self-reported on themselves like that. Why is that? Because we're real good at seeing other people's faults and overlooking our own. It's our nature, right? We used to play a little poker game, and I had a two of clubs here somewhere, and I've lost it. Lynn, did you take that? Sorry. And here's how it worked. Everybody got a card, and nobody got to see their own card. You put the card on your head, your forehead. A lot of you have played this. Everybody gets to see what card you have, but you get to see everybody else's card. And then you bet based on what you see. You might look around and say, you've only got a 3. You got a 4, come on. And you're sitting there with a 2 and you don't know it. Isn't that a picture of how our hearts tend to be? How we observe with the closest of inspection, other people's sin. Boy, we see it. And we overlook that log in our own eye. May the Lord give us sensitivity to our own faults. It's kind of like how you can smell other people's bad breath, but you can't smell your own. Now, my brother, I have a brother that's almost 10 years older than me, and when he was in college, he played tennis, the college team, and I was about 10 years old at the time, just learning to play tennis, and I kept hitting the ball into the net, right? It wouldn't go over the net like it's supposed to. Well, he came out, and we played together, and he gave me three tips that transformed my tennis game. Very basic. Keep your eye on the ball. I guess I wasn't doing that. Step into your swing and follow through on your swing. Three basic things that changed my tennis game. I started being a decent tennis player and hitting the ball over the net just from those basics. So I want to give you two basic things, not even three, that I'm hoping you will remember about how to understand what the scripture means, because we're looking at what do not judge means today. Number one, ask this question: what is the context? Who's it written to? But especially, what has just been said? What's going on? Because when we pull one verse out of context, we're almost sure to misunderstand it. So that's the first basic question that will make you good at being a Bible interpreter. What is the context? The second question you want to ask is, what does the rest of the Bible say about this subject? Because God, the Holy Spirit, has inspired all of the scripture, and so that means that it teaches, he doesn't contradict himself, even though it may appear that way to us at times. So you want to ask the question, what else does scripture teach on judging, for example? So let's continue looking at the context and that idea of context. Now, this is a true story. I read about a new Christian. He was looking for guidance, and he decided to take a shortcut, just open the Bible and trust that God would give him guidance by whatever passage he opened to. He opened up to Hosea chapter 1, verse 2, "Go marry a prostitute and have children with her." This actually happened. So that's the kind of thing that happens when we take the scripture out of context. So continue on with the context of what does it mean, do not judge. Verse 5, "You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye." Is removing the speck from your brother's eye a good thing here? It is. Not only if you've already taken the log or plank out of your own, right? You're actually taking it out so you can see clearly. So it's not a bad thing. Scripture doesn't teach don't correct people in love and humility. It doesn't teach that. It teaches to do that. But it teaches that you got to deal with your own sin first. Now, let's look more at context. Verse 6, "Do not give dogs what is sacred. Do not throw your pearls to pigs. If you do, they may trample them under their feet and turn and tear you to pieces." It's not talking about literal dogs and pigs. It's talking about people. Does that require a kind of a judgment? In fact, you could even say the Sermon on the Mount is the most judgmental material in all of literature. In one sense, depending on how you define judging. What this is teaching is that you should teach in accord with the spiritual capacity of those who are hearing it. Look at verse 13 as we are looking at the context to try to understand what do not judge means. "Watch out for false prophets." And verse 20, "Thus by their fruit you will recognize them." Does that require a certain kind of judging? Sure does. You're judging their fruit. You're examining their fruit and deciding, are they false or a true teacher? So, I've spent a lot of time at LBCC talking to college students just doing a little gospel presentations over there. And I ask them if they think they're a good person, and they usually say yes. And I say, well, somebody knows you really well. What would they say is good about you? Give them a chance to brag on themselves a little bit. And often I hear this: I am very tolerant. I don't judge anyone. Whatever their religion is, whoever they love, doesn't matter. I don't judge anyone. This is considered the ultimate value, tolerance. So as the world defines tolerance. He cheated on his wife, but who am I to judge? We're all sinners, right? Or someone is corrected and they say, you're judging me. You have no right to do that. And maybe they are, and maybe they're not. But this verse, do not judge, is not a get out of jail free to do anything you want. A jail free card. Look at that command and the reason for the command again in verse 5. You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. The command, take the plank out of your eye, the reason, so you can see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. There's a great example in Scripture of someone who needed to hear these words. It's King David. David was seeing Bathsheba. He didn't know that's who it was. Beautiful woman bathing on a roof, and he had her summoned to come to him, and another man's wife, Uriah the Hittite, and he slept with her. She became pregnant. He needed to cover up his act. His initial attempts didn't work, so he ended up having him sent out on the battlefield to a dangerous place where he would be killed, and he was killed. A year or so goes by, and Nathan the prophet comes up to David and tells him a story. He says, there was a man, two men. One was wealthy, one was poor. The wealthy man had all kinds of animals. The poor man had one ewe lamb that he loved, and he loved him so much he slept with him, and he meant all the world to him, this ewe lamb. And there was a visitor who came and needed to be fed, and this rich man, instead of taking one of his many animals, took this poor man's only animal, the ewe lamb that he loved, and cooked it up for the visitor. And David said, he deserves to die. And Nathan said, you are the man. Take the plank out of your own eye first. And he did. Fortunately, David repented. And you can read about that in Psalm 51, his repentance. So the fact is, if you do the second question, remember context, what's the context of the first question? The second question is, what does the rest of the Bible say? If you do that on judging, you might be confused because you'll read, do not judge, do judge. It's not simple. So I've summarized it in this way. I think this is an accurate portrayal of what the Scripture teaches about judging. Do not judge in this sense. Make sure you have the information before you make a judgment. Do not judge with a critical, judgmental spirit towards other people. And do not judge in a hypocritical way where you need to deal with your own sin before you deal with someone else's. So you could say, do judge, make judgments, don't be judgmental. Now, I've come across a great tool for examining that part of our heart that tends towards being critical and judgmental of people. And I want to read these statements. This is a woman named Nancy DeMoss. Some of you might have heard her on Christian radio. And she came out with this thing on revival that compares a person who has a proud heart versus a person who has a broken or humble heart. And there's seven statements, proud people do this, broken people do this. I want you to fill in your own name as I read these statements and see which rings true, the proud part or the broken part. Would you close your eyes and just listen to these seven statements? Again, as I say proud people, say your own name to yourself and see if it rings true. Same with broken people. Proud people focus on the failures of others. Broken people are overwhelmed with a sense of their own spiritual need. Proud people have a critical, fault-finding spirit, look at everyone else's fault with a microscope, but their own with a telescope. Broken people are compassionate, can forgive much because they know how much they have been forgiven. Proud people are self-righteous and look down on others. Broken people esteem all others better than themselves. Proud people compare themselves with others and feel worthy of honor. Broken people compare themselves to the holiness of God and feel a desperate need for His mercy. Proud people are blind to their true heart condition. Broken people walk in the light. Proud people don't think they have anything to repent of. Broken people realize they have a need of continual heart attitude of repentance. And finally, proud people don't think they need a revival, but are sure that everyone else does. Broken people continually sense their need for a fresh encounter with God and for a fresh filling of His Holy Spirit. You can open your eyes. Actually, we're going to pray. I'm going to close in prayer, and then I want to, Warren mentioned Truth Talk. I want to just say something briefly about that in case you're interested so you know how to access that after I pray. All right, you're welcome to stand or stay seated, whatever you want to do as I pray here. Lord, thank You for the glorious gospel. Thank You for the mercy and the grace that has been shown to us. Thank You that though we deserve Your judgment, because of what Jesus has done, we don't stand under Your judgment today if we are in Christ. Praise You for that. Now may that non-judgmental attitude flow in and out of our hearts towards other people. May we be patient, may we be kind, may we be gentle, and yet at the same time, may we be discerning and make good judgments and love people enough to correct them when that is what is called for. Lord, help us. We all recognize we have a heart that sees people's faults very well and overlooks our own. May that be reversed in us. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hey everyone, I just want to say thanks a lot for watching the video today. Really appreciate that. One thing you can do to help us out is by subscribing to this channel, then hitting, you know, the bell, notifications, making a comment. The more that happens, the easier it is to find us. So if you can help us out, that would be great. Thanks again for watching us today. Have an awesome day.